This is David Vai, editor at Microwave Journal, and it is my pleasure to welcome our audience to today's webinar discussing the use of advanced EDA design tools to implement a 60 gigahertz three-stage power amplifier for the emerging wireless HDMI standard. Our speaker today will be Michael Thompson from Agilent Technologies, who will take a look at different amplifier technologies, interstage matching and their trade-offs, the use of planar 3D EM analysis and design techniques, constrained layout and physical design, including design rule checking and layout versus schematic, performance verification to the 60 gigahertz 4 gigabit per second wireless HDMI standard, as well as considerations for fabrication and testing. The three-stage power amplifier to be presented was designed using TriQuint's TQP13N foundry process design kit. The sponsor for today's webinar is Agilent Technologies, providers of Agilent EESoft EDA. Agilent EESoft EDA is the technology leader and the industry's leading supplier of electronic design automation software for microwave, RF, high-frequency, high-speed, RF system, electronic system level, circuit, 3D electromagnetic, physical design, and device modeling applications. Agilent EESoft EDA offers personal, value-priced products as well as enterprise-level solutions that save money, improve design flows, and simplify EDA vendor relationships. Agilent EESoft EDA software is compatible with and is used to design the company's test and measurement equipment. Additional information about all of Agilent EDA's software offerings is available at www.agilent.com/find/EESoft. Today's presentation will be approximately 45 minutes long, after which we will hold a 15-minute question and answer session with our presenter from Agilent. You may submit a question through this website at any time during the presentation. However, the questions will not be answered until the presentation is complete. This presentation will be archived and available for viewing later on the resource section of the Microwave Journal website. Please give us about 24 hours to post that. Also, at the end of this presentation and during the question and answer session, you will see a URL link to a very special survey that Agilent EESoft has posted as a companion to this webinar. Our speaker today is Michael Thompson, the U.S. Applications Engineering District Manager with Agilent Technologies. Mike has been an application engineer for the past 13 years. Prior to HP Agilent, he was a senior staff special with the Aerojet Electro System in the passive sensor department for 10 years, where he designed microwave and millimeter wave components, systems, and antennas. Prior to Aerojet, Mike was with the Hughes Aircraft in the Antenna Array Lab as a member of the technical staff, where he worked in the design of MIC and MMIC phased array antennas. So now, here is Michael.
Good day, everyone. Thank you for joining today. Just quickly to give you a little idea of how this project came about, it was in response to Agilent and TriQuint kind of partnering and looking at improving the overall design flow within ADS as some of the traditional tools, like I said, are sort of sunsetting here. And so we were looking for a test vehicle to try to get an understanding of what was lacking in the flows now and how we could really make a flow effective for the designer. And at the same time, we wanted to prove out some of the new TriQuint processes, the TQP 25, 15, and 13 models and processes that have been released. So we looked at kind of an emerging standard. We'll talk a little bit more about this for basically transmitting high-definition television, much like you have your wireless hub at home for internet access. You would have a similar sort of hub for high-definition television. So we picked this 60 gigahertz PA. We knew we'd be pushing the technology a little bit, but that's what we wanted to do. But we also wanted to have some vehicle for testing out Agilent's EESoft's new complete flow that we're calling our desktop flow that has a DRC and LVS component, as well as showcasing the performance of this particular process. So if you want to understand a little bit more about this flow, we have a website you can link into. You do need to get into the Agilent Knowledge Center. We'll get you a password for that or get you into the site. And within it, you have the complete MMIC flow that you can go back to as a reference after this talk and see all the different elements, see how designs are captured, simulated, But the most important thing that I'm hoping you can take away from this today is that within this single environment, you really do have the complete flow, and you'll be able to see we can do everything within this environment we need to do to design, build, and test this amplifier. So I think most of us are very familiar with the kind of flow we need nowadays to build, in addition to a MMIC or a module, any sort of electrical component we need to accurately characterize the devices, which TriQuint has done a very good job in this kit of characterizing the individual transistors, having good built-in models inside the PDKs. But in addition, we have to really understand the medium we're going to be working in this case microstrip on top of gas, looking at how it performs, coupling both empirical models as well as EM type models, and being able to work at several different levels within a single environment. It just makes it a faster process, a more efficient process, being able to look at die level in a package or on a carrier and then within a higher level package, and then being able to relate our measurements back to our simulations. So this was, like I said, a testing vehicle for the flow, and it was one of those things where a slot became opened up on a wafer run. It was a very quick turnaround for the design, and what we'll find here is when I did try to rush this design and I did it without any EM simulation up front, we'll see that we reaffirm this lesson that when you leave out EM nowadays, especially at these frequencies, it does bite you. So we'll be able to see those effects and see what happens when we do come back later at another point and start to include those effects and look at it. So we're going to talk loosely about the specification. Some of the high-definition television specs are under consortium control, so we're going to discuss this very broadly as to what type of specs we're looking for. So it'll be just a sort of a description of what type of signal we're trying to transmit. We're then going to go through briefly which process we picked. We'll be looking at some stability. We'll be talking about a little bit about the device matching, how we cascaded those together and the initial simulations we looked at, as well as some EM simulations later on, and then looking at some of the actual measurements once we near the end and the measurement setup itself. So the WPAN signal is this particular IEEE standard. It's a standard that's set up for in-home commercial use, 10-meter extended typical range around which the base station would transmit to the receiver, 1080p signals for high-definition television. So we're particularly looking at the physical layer here. The high data rate, the 4 gigabit rate, is what we're looking at here for the OFDM signal. We'll be looking at amplifying to get about a 13 dBm output range for this particular application. And we haven't discussed yet the LNA, but hopefully at some future date we'll be able to switch to the receive side and pick that up as well. But this was the basic sort of standard we were looking to satisfy. And within that, if we look at our channels, we can see that most of the channels are right around the 60 gigahertz range for the high data rate. We have some lower data rate plans. We're really focused on the high data rate channels for this particular project. Again, we chose the TriQuint TQP13 process. It has self-aligning gates. It has a very good FFT. Around 95 gigahertz, and it utilizes an optical lithography process that will help us in the cost efficiencies we're going to need for something that would be commercially available for home use, large production rates. It's a two-metal process with all the integrated passives as well as the devices within it. So normally when I started design, pretty much any design, I have some equations that sit around on my my HP calculator that I've had for years that are programmed in for. First, I'm just really concerned about what wavelength is like in the medium I'm working in, be it waveguide, strip line, or in this case, microstrip. And I'm kind of curious about what impedances my lines or thicknesses are going to be for certain impedances along the microstrip. And all of this has been documented many times before, but this is a particularly good microstrip line reference. That's how I usually get started, to give me an idea of what lines are like. Certainly within ADS and within several tools in industry, there are more sophisticated programs for predicting it. But the my sort of approximate rules usually get me a pretty good ballpark and get me started as to what line size I'm looking for and links. One of the reasons that that's going to be important for us, and I need to apologize, we got the arrow switched on my Smith chart here, is these long stubs, although they start out, you know, we have an open at the end of the stub, a very high impedance on the Smith chart. As we rotate towards the generator or towards the main line here, that impedance drops lower and lower. As you can see on the Smith chart, this is the transmission line equations. And you're going to see that when we start to do things, whether we have junctions or whether we have other devices being mounted there, anytime you're in some of this low impedance points, the left side of the Smith chart, all manufacturing, processing, mounting, any type of tolerance or variation that you have there is going to move your design around considerably. So whenever we can avoid such points, I always try to do so. And so I just want to start to have an idea of what sizes start to approach things that I need to worry about from an impedance standpoint. So that's my first sort of understanding of what my design is going to be like. And then my second one was, what does this device look like? What is it going to be doing at 60 gigahertz where I'm trying to design? So I first just pulled up from the Amplifier Design Guide inside of ADS a template for looking at the S parameters, the noise figure gain stability, and mounting the adding the device here. I've instantiated it. I'm just doing a straight source to ground common source configuration here. And you see on the lower right-hand side the little icon that's the TQP13 netlist include icon. That's including the models, and that comes from the TriQuint PDK. And you can see I'm using the TOM4 model here. And there's some other parameters that I can add, and we can talk about those a little later, mainly varying the process statistics, turning them off or on, and looking at what this might do from a statistical standpoint. We'll take a look at that in brief, but that's the interface as to where I control which model and how I'm setting up my process for the simulation. So we run the simulation, and we're going to get some results here, and this is a predefined template within the ADS environment, so this just pops up, and you see it's going to give us quite a bit of information. We can see, you know, maximum available gain, power gain, noise figures, as well as some of our stability circles. And it will also give us a matching condition for whether we're matching for gain, which in this case I was looking for to bring the baseband signal up, or for matching more for a noise match. Now in this case, in the upper right-hand corner, when we look at our stability factor, mainly looking at K, we can see, and I apologize, I know this is probably very hard for you to see on your machine, but the K factor is just barely above 1, so we're just barely stable at this point. And we know with any sort of manufacturing tolerances, any sort of variation in the process, impedances or things around that device, that it's quite easy to move the stability. So we're already a little concerned about that. Within this template, we also have the availability of gain curves, noise circles, stability analysis. All this has been predefined, so you can start by getting a very broad understanding of what the device looks like at different frequencies. It's easy to move our sliders here, our selector, and look at different frequencies and understand what's going on with the device.